young programmers, especially when they start their careers initially, they start getting into writing real production code, and no more they are into doing that learning and test code and stuff like that. So I see various cases they kind of tend to get that confusion, and I do have some sessions with them and they have confusion with respect to it can be so trivial. They may do some blunders in terms of something like following certain coding standards, the way the a specific company enforces it, the development team or engineering teams enforces it, and other than that they also lack sometimes doing proper code formatting or indentation and stuff like that. And apart from that, besides these aspects, they also be kind of confused in which case to use which construct. So in that way, in this episode I would like to discuss about using some kind of loop statements, because this is where often I do like certain constructs and I don't like certain constructs as a point of architectural perspective. So this is a sort of video which I would like to give some reasoning behind, so that this is a sort of architectural decision rather than showing your own programming skills. So this is why I thought let me cover some video, something just about using loop constructs like while loop, for loop and do while and stuff like that. So when you study about programming, they teach about the significance of pseudocode, writing pseudocodes, and as well as flowcharts and stuff like that, and then followed by which how do you translate this algorithms or your logic, what you imagine in terms of getting something fulfilled into a real working program. But if you consider in the real world cases, not necessarily you need all the times a flowchart. Sometimes architects or the software designers may do some sort of vague flowchart which represents the flow of that entire module or entire high level design of that entire project or something like that. And apart from that, they may also kind of segregate each modules and then they may do individual flowcharts for module wise specific operations. So in a way, if you translate that directly in a code, you can put some looping statements, some as for loop, some as do while and stuff like that. So this is where you should also understand, as we progress towards the way modern approach, sometimes you never need any sort of programming life cycle like you study in the college. So in a way, if you think about Linux kernel, who does a flowchart for each kernel module? So it's just bullshit actually. So you never need all those things. You never need a pseudocode and stuff. You can directly start with your code and you can define the APIs, you can write stub APIs, and then you can define the flow, and then you can start writing the real code within each of these APIs and data structures. So this is what happens in the real world case. If you ask me about how I did traffic squeezer or trophy, I never did any of these steps which you do in or study in college. So this is how most of the times even things work in the real world as well. So this is what it is. But having said that, if you are working in a team comprising a lot of engineers and stuff like that, of course you need to follow certain guidelines so that it makes it easy for everyone to collaborate and work together as a whole. So that way, if you see, there will be a lot of confusion exists in which condition, which kind of looping statement use. And of course, I'm not going to discuss about which case what sort of looping statement you need to use and stuff. That this video entirely is not about it. So in general, that you can understand that you may have a while loop so that you can have a condition, and then you can put all your code inside that specific condition. And sometimes if you need the code to run first and then you need to have that condition in the end, then you can use do until or do while, something like that. So, and apart from that, you have any numbered lists and other stuff, you can use a for loop and all. But if you see the real world cases, sometimes, most of the times, you may have some counter specific loops and stuff like that. So in any case, if you have anything which is something related to a counter, all I would suggest is to use a for loop. Never use that stupid do until or while loops at all. So this is one thing I often see many people using while loops, and then they have their own opinions, and they have their own perspective on using while loop, even for counter specific loops. So this is what I would like to suggest you to stick always with for loops. The reason is, let it be not so optimized, unlike something like while loop. The for loop is always going to give a reliable code, and also it is going to give you more structured code and also human readable code, unlike if you compare something like while loops. So if you have consider a for loop, so you can see here you can have some sort of an iteration, something like this. I less than, you can give some number, or it can be some variable, less than a, and then I plus plus, you can give something like that. So let's take an example. This particular code can be in C, it can be in C++, it can be in Perl, Python, Java, whatever it is. You can have the similar construct, whether it is whichever language you consider. So similarly, let's take example of while loop. You can think something like I less than A, something like that. So I don't want to be too precise, so I'm just doing something very simple, so something do until, and then you can have some condition in that. So each case, let's assume each one is counter specific iterations. You need to do iterations for n number of times based on a specific counter or something. You should always choose to use for loop. As you can see here, it is as simple as like this. You have defined the sequential operation of this iterative parameter like this, or index variable like this. You have mentioned I++, and then you have also mentioned the condition at which the loop should exit, and as well as you have mentioned the initialization of this index variable. Whereas if you use a while loop, you need to make sure that somewhere you initialize the same, and somewhere you kind of I++, somewhere you don't miss, and you should not fail to increment the same, and then you can have your own stuff, and of course you have this condition. So this is something some people when they translate to an assembly, they think it is a lot more optimized versus something like a for loop or something. You should understand, just forget about optimization. You should understand have two things in criteria when you architect something, is the reliability and also the readability. The readability, the more code is readable, the more you can maintain the code. You don't have to deal with some kind of weird bugs as and when you expand this code, and as you add more and more logic into the same. And there is also one more advantage is, let's assume you have some variable, so b equal to say 100 or 200, and somewhere you are incrementing b plus equal to 2 or something like that. In case if you have a for loop, you can just merge the same over here. This is not anything new, of course you will know the same. So b plus, let's say for example b plus plus, something like that. In this case, suppose b plus plus, you have it here, and in this way you can just move it over here. So this way you can just club any such statement so that it is all put together, so that each iteration, what and all steps you need to do unconditionally for that iteration, you can, if possible, you can kind of club them together this way. So this is one of the main advantages. You can see indirectly it adds that readability, and as well as it also improves that maintainability of the code, and also it reduces the number of bugs. And in case if you have any bugs, it is also easy to debug. Just imagine the same thing you doing in a while loop. You can see the mess around. So this is the sort of mess you need to deal with a while loop of any sort of counter specific iterations you need, and as well as if you have any do until similar kind of crap you need to manage even with this construct as well. So I always suggest forget about any sort of optimization, just think about reliability and as well as human readability, because you need to do a code which is readable for humans. If you are so talented, if you are a veteran programmer, you are so talented in programming, better directly do in assembly. Why do you need to do in C? So that's what it is. So since you need to do programming in human readable language, focus on, you know, readability. The more code is readable, you can share your code, somebody else in your team can also read and understand the same, and in case if it has any bugs, they can also fix in case, and easy to understand, easy to debug, easy to maintain and manage your code, rather than, you know, you do all sorts of tricks, you know, with your you know, coding skills. So this is what I thought it is interesting thing to discuss, because these things are not so important, these are very trivial things, but as and when you start developing this habit, the more mature seasoned programmer you become, the more overcomplicated you may end up writing your code, rather than doing something like this and finishing what it is supposed to do. So this way, no matter whatever the language you use, just think which is the coding construct which is much easier to understand and easier to use. Just stick with the same and then follow this as a coding guidelines, and in case if you grow in your career, once you tend to become lead of a team or some kind of manager of a team, and in case if you put forward your own coding standards for any specific project, so that time what you can do is you can mention all these coding guidelines, you can mention all these coding guidelines, you can share it with your team members, and you can ask them to follow these kind of constructs, so that it looks unified, the code can be more easily understood by other team members as well. It's just not a question of whether you are using a for loop or while loop, it's just a question of how easy you manage the code and how you can simplify, you know, something which is already complicated. You never know what you end up, you know, writing inside this for loop. It may have around 600 lines of source, who knows actually. So this is what it is. If you explore the kernel source easily, any API, if you see, some of the APIs may have 300 to 400 lines in one single API, and sometimes even in one single loop you may have hundreds of lines of code. So in that way, already it's a complicated loop, in that you are actually over complicating by putting a huge some while loop this way, and then here you are adding some 300 lines of code, and then you are suddenly doing an incrementation of index variable over here, and in case if you miss the same, or in case if you just who is editing this code or something, it happens, in case if it misses, then it is going to lead into some serious issues, or it can be not so simple like this way, but if it has something else. So what happens is, if somebody misses doing this, now it adds that confusion, and unnecessarily you need to deal this bug, and then you need to find what it is happening, you need to use some debugger, which is also a waste of time, you need to debug the code, which is also a waste of time, and you need to go through all this cycles to fix this issue, which is, it can be very well avoided by sticking to a coding standard which is more intuitive, human readable, easy to manage, easy to maintain, and easy to understand. So apart from that, if you ask me, whenever I do any infinite loops, generally the only that point of time I may use a while loop, and most of the times in general I would like to use a for loop, because again it gives that convenience, and even for infinite loops I do like using for loops at some specific cases, like you have a specific case, like you can have an infinite loop, hope you know this construct, you can use this way, you can have it for infinite loops. And apart from that, in case if you need to operate a specific construct, or you need to increment something, decrement something, you can use this way, so that it happens at each iteration. And if not, you can also use I generally use a you know, while loop, something like this, so that it is sufficient for an infinite loop situation. So most of the times, so whenever you write any network application, of course these applications run in the background and these applications run forever, so obviously you need an infinite loop, not like you have some case like this many iterations or something like that. It has to run in the background. It will run in the background forever as long as that process is alive. So in that way you can use definitely an infinite loop, something like this, and very rarely if there is any condition or something and it doesn't have any iterations apart from a very explicit condition, and only in that cases I'll use some kind of a while loop and something like this. Say suppose a is less than 100 or less than 10, something like that, or else sometimes in PHP something like that, a is equal to true, something like that. So apart from that, I never use any other constructor like do, until, and all that bullshit as such, because the reason I generally don't like is it adds lot of confusion. Please understand, what you read in books is something else, what you do a real production source is completely different. So don't always follow some theory and then just assume things that this is how production code is made. It is often true, but as the way we evolved, as the way things are going forward, a lot of things has been discovered in the field of programming as well, in the field of IT, and there are modern languages, modern approaches, and also modern situations wherein which you never need something which just for the reason you studied in the book. Don't assume the things that it is just like that used in the industry. It is not the case. So most of the times, so try to use for loop and try to have an habit so that you can attempt using for loop for most of the cases. If it is something outright, something condition, something like that, you can use something while loop, because you don't need end of the day some weird for loop, something like this, and then something like this where in which you put a condition and then you don't do any initialization or incrementation steps or something like that. Of course you can do this, even this is valid, but unfortunately this it defeats the purpose. It makes the code difficult to understand, because this itself says that you are initiating a for loop. It itself says that it has to run, and then suddenly you are putting a condition at this weird space. Instead you can do a simple while. This improves the readability. So other than few cases or other than any condition specific cases, never use any while loops. Other than that, if it is anything related to counter specific, anything always related with respect to number of counts and stuff like that, always stick to for loops, as simple as that. So hope you guys loved watching this video. In case if you have any questions, please be in touch in mail. Thank you once again for watching this video. Stay tuned. Have a nice day. Bye bye.